All right, that's all we can do with that, Will. Otherwise, we'll get copyright.
Yes, but
our podcast will get the living audio files copyrighted out of it.
Oh, yeah. But anyway, with that, happy start of the football season, guys.
Ooh.
This is our year, Isaac. I feel it.
The Bills?
I think the Bills are going to the Super Bowl, and I think they're winning this year.
Oh, yeah. Anybody who says otherwise is wrong.
They're just wrong. You're just being negative. Be more optimistic. The Bills are going to win this year.
Yeah.
I mean, Josh Allen is on the cover of the newest Madden game.
So
that's a good omen, right?
Oh, yes.
That's a good omen.
Even though we lost our first game.
Okay. That was just...
But the first
that was
will be
fluke.
Last, and the last
like,
will be first.
Like, the Bills, like, they need to readjust. They're just getting warmed up. It was...
Right, right.
You know, they're just trying to keep things interesting. They don't want to get Bills fans' hopes too high, because you know how crazy Bills fans can get when they like what's happening.
Oh, yeah.
Like, I'm still remembering that one Dolphins game from last year where they were throwing snowballs onto the field.
Oh, really?
You don't remember that?
No.
Oh, yeah, the...
Am I not a Bills fan or something?
I guess you're not a Bills fan, because that was such an iconic game. Like, the refs literally had to threaten to, like, penalize the Bills because, like, the fans were throwing so many snowballs and it was affecting the players.
That's hilarious.
It was so funny.
Wow. Refs suck, man. The refs are always the worst part of any football game.
Yeah.
No matter what team you root for, you can agree on that.
There's, like, corruption in the, like... Because
anti-Bills corruption.
Well, no, not just anti-Bills. Because like the refs somehow managed to be biased against both teams.
Okay, that's true.
Like I think they're like told to like call bogus penalties just to keep the game more interesting.
I mean,
because like if the game is like really close, you want that makes the ratings go up.
Oh,
if it's just a landslide victory all the time, every freaking time, then
that does sound a little bit corrupt.
Like nobody's gonna watch.
Right.
But anyway,
you know,
regardless of referee corruption, we're going to win this year.
Oh, yeah. And that makes me very happy as a man.
It does. And when the Bills lose, that makes me very depressed as a man.
Well, it's interesting that you bring that up, Will.
What? Well, how interesting.
Because we're going to talk about...
What an unplanned transition.
We're going to talk about men today.
Men? Whoa. I like talking about men.
We're going to have... A discussion about men's feelings.
Our
little
feelings.
Crybaby's feelings. We're going to talk about our feelings.
Men's feelings matter.
That's true.
You all matter. If you're a man and you're listening, you matter.
What about if you're a woman?
If you're a woman, you also matter.
Amen.
Because we all matter to Jesus Christ. And who matters to him is all that matters.
That's true.
And as long as we...
Life under the sun.
As long as he matters to us the most, more than anything in the world... Then we're
life
gonna be
under
saved.
The sun is worthless, but life under the sun is worth everything.
It's a good saying. Where'd you hear that?
I don't know. It's not like I've been listening to a series on Ecclesiastes recently or anything.
Our church is doing a series on Ecclesiastes, and it's making me really happy.
Oh,
yes. It had a really good sermon today.
Oh, it's interesting that makes you happy, because Ecclesiastes is like one of the more depressing books of the Bible.
Well, it starts off depressing, but it ends hopefully.
True.
It's like sort of, I don't know how to put it, but like it's... Like, it brings you down, but then it raises you up. Like, that's
right.
Like that's the whole point of it.
Yeah.
Like, first, it starts out by making you realize how hopeless everything is and how, like, nothing in the world matters. But then it says, oh, wait,
nothing
stuff does
really
matter
matters.
Because God exists.
Nothing
and as long as God
really
is the center of us,
to me.
Is the center of our universe, is the center of, like, our life, things do matter and we matter.
Well, you know, I think that's what a lot of people get wrong today, William. Because the number of people worldwide who are actually happy is about 64%.
64%?
Which I thought was a little high when I heard that. I was like, wow, a lot of people, more people are happy than I thought. But.
Wait, where was this, like, how is this poll taken?
I do not know, but I know that the number drops.
Okay.
The number drops to only 27% when you're in the U.S.
Ooh.
Which, like.
That doesn't surprise me.
Only 27% of people are happy. That's sad. I mean, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And then Finland is apparently the world's happiest country. So what's up with that?
What is Finland doing that we aren't? Why are people in Finland
so
happy? What is even in Finland?
Ice, probably.
Ice? See, I live...
Blonde girls.
I oh. Oh,
there
well,
you
that
go. There you go. That'll do it.
I was going to say, I live... I live in a part of the world where it's icy half of the year, and that's like the most depressing part.
I know. It is.
I mean, I love how snow looks. I love like the winter aesthetic.
Right.
But like dealing with snow and ice, like having to go out an hour earlier, like get up an hour earlier than I usually would to shovel the driveway. I don't like that.
Yeah, it's not fun.
It's not fun.
But why are you know, Matt Walsh made this good point that whenever we're talking about happiness in the world, we always discriminate based on, you know, how happy are the women, how happy are the trans people, how happy are this favored group over this favored group. And then we always leave out men, right? Like the media always leaves out men. Like
the media, yeah.
We rarely talk about how men are doing. And
I feel like most normal people, rational people, would care about men.
Right.
Or at least not big media people, because like you see all sorts of smaller like commentators talk about men.
True.
Because they actually care.
Yeah. But the men wouldn't necessarily know that, because depressed men aren't generally that social, right? So
it's true.
It's somewhat hard for them to. But anyway, I did some research for this discussion because I thought I should.
I did not.
Well, we both watched a shoe on head video about
the male loneliness
epidemic. So when I Googled a couple of things that I found quite interesting. So when I Googled, this is what auto-filled when I Googled. So what percentage of men are blank? So Google all auto-fill. Sorry, I can't speak today, which means it's a great thing that I'm doing a podcast. But Google all auto-filled things like this. So what percentage of men are over 6 feet? What percentage?
Did you click on that?
No, because I do not care.
Oh.
We can Google it later. What percentage of men are virgins? What percentage of men are bald? And what percentage of men are sexual perpetrators?
Whoa, what the heck?
Yeah, all of these search results are negative, right?
That's
true. Like over 6 feet. Are they judging us for
being
our height
a virgin,
now?
Are you saying being a virgin is negative? Are you saying being a virgin is bad?
No.
You're saying
no,
keep
but,
hold, help, holding yourself back until marriage is a
bad thing?
But
it's used as
an
insult, commonly.
Oh,
right?
Fair point.
And then I did the same thing for women. It autofilled women. So,
oh, okay.
What percentage of women in it autofilled are sexually assaulted?
Okay.
Are on birth control and are stay-at-home moms? And then what percentage of women are overweight?
Interesting.
Now, it seems like even down to our autofill on Google, we're kind of making men seem worse than they are. And we're kind of making women seem more victimized than they are. Like, what percentage of women are sexually assaulted?
Fair point there. But I don't think being a stay-at-home mom is victimized.
Oh, no, no. No, not at all.
Being a stay-at-home mom is a really cool thing.
I would agree. I want to be a stay-at-home mom when I grow up.
you do
just
that.
Kidding.
You achieve your dreams,
just
Isaac.
Kidding.
You go chase them.
Right. But apparently only 40.4% of men are happy compared to 53.4% of women.
So it's around half for both.
No, it's not. It's less. It's way less than half for men.
Well, 43%. Well, that's...
It's 40.4%.
40. Okay, so 10%.
And then 53.4% of women are happy, apparently. So what's going on culturally? Why are we so...
Lack of purpose.
Yeah?
I think that's a big one.
As it talks about in Ecclesiastes?
Yes, exactly. Like we just talked about today at our church.
Exactly.
Great sermon.
Oh, yes.
A little side tangent. Probably one of my favorite sermons I've heard in a while. From our pastor.
Well, okay then.
Honestly.
Yeah.
I mean, I just love the book of Ecclesiastes, so I love hearing about it.
I cannot disagree. But still, it's like we're running a campaign against men in society, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Like, even down to Google's autofill, where we're Googling things that kind of insult men.
Yeah.
Like, why aren't you over 6 feet tall? Why are you bald? Why are you a sexual perpetrator? And what Shoe on Head was talking about is, like, no wonder Andrew Tate has become so popular recently.
Well, yeah.
No wonder people like that.
Andrew Tate is, like, the one, like, popular person who's saying, no, men do matter. And if you tell a culture of a bunch of depressed men that they matter, they're gonna listen because they're not being insulted for once.
Right. Right. And then at the same time, you have all these liberals who are basically saying that men are pathetic because they're feeling bad. And then they're like, well, let's make men feel happy so that they'll listen to us because we're liberals and we're right.
Mm-hmm.
And men are really having a hard time of it between those two extremes, right?
I guess.
Because you have something that I would call the war of the sexes, really. Where one side is always a jerk to the other, right? You ever notice that? Like, recently men have started thinking of all women as jerks.
Well, you always have, like, that group. Well, you always have, like, that extreme group of men who hate women, and you have the extreme group of women who hate men.
Right, but those groups are becoming less, like, less extreme, I would say.
Less extreme? I don't think so.
I would say it's enveloping more of the population, because we're seeing the decline of marriage rates. We're seeing the decline of birth rates. We're seeing more sleeping around, so we're basically just using people of the opposite gender as sex objects for ourselves. And then you have the rise of, you know, feminism, radical feminism, not just we want equal rights feminism, mm-hmm. but feminism that says that all men are bald sexual perpetrators.
Well, I still don't think the majority of women think that way. Like, sure, like, the marriage rates are declining, but I think there are other factors that, like, lead into that. I don't think it's just hating the other sex.
Yeah.
I still think, like, the actual, like, amount of people who genuinely, like, actually hate the other sex, like, want them to, like not be a part of their lives at all, is still very small.
Yeah, I'm not saying that it's become the majority. I'm just saying it's becoming more common.
Well, yeah.
Right?
Yeah, I guess.
On the other hand, you have all the male self-help people. So you have all the feminists who hate men.
Mm-hmm.
And their ideology is seeping into culture more and more, or at least the logical end of it, like transgenderism and stuff like that. And then you have all the people on the other side who are like, well, all women suck too. Mm-hmm. And we're becoming more polarized and more polarized. And the difference is that women are now having the upper hand in culture, right? Like,
are they?
Yeah. I would say so. Because now a woman can accuse some boy of raping her and we'll all act like the boy is guilty. You ever notice that?
I've seen tons of cases like that. And, like, just the accusation alone is enough to ruin a guy's life.
I know.
And that's awful.
Yeah.
Because, like, you could be the most well-behaved, like, man on the planet. You could just be a normal dude living a normal life, working a job, making money, having, like, harmless hobbies, and then you have like one small interaction with the woman, and then you get accused. Maybe you didn't even interact with her. Maybe you're just in her presence, and then you get accused of rape, and then your entire life, is destroyed.
And it's no wonder that men are now so depressed, and it's no wonder that they now know that they now think that no one cares about them, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's no wonder that when you know, of course, it all comes back to falling away from Jesus.
Yeah.
When you fall away from Jesus, it's true to an extent that no one actually does care about you.
Mm-hmm.
Because we're all selfish without Christ. So we care about ourselves chiefly.
Well, like, you know, you always have to have a quote unquote God in your life. And if it's not the one true God, then it's going to be yourself.
Right.
You're going to treat yourself as a quote unquote God.
Right.
Yeah.
But I think what is the solution to this male loneliness and unhappiness epidemic?
I'm gonna give the Sunday school answer here and just say Jesus.
Okay, but culturally speaking, what changes need to happen? Because it's easy for us to just say Jesus.
Yeah, I know. I was being a little.
I know you are.
I know. I was making a joke there, but you know my point still stands. That like, at a certain point, the ultimate solution to all our problems is going to be Jesus Christ. But I guess the next question after that is, how do we bring ourselves culturally back to Jesus?
Yeah, and especially in the context of making men men again. Because since we have this war on the sexes, and men don't want to be real men anymore, traditionally masculine men, since they don't want to do that because they don't think it's worth it, they don't think women are worth it, how do we present the gospel of Christ to men in a way that prioritizes them trusting in Christ and grabbing onto their masculine identity? Because I don't think that having, you know, grasping onto your identity as what God created you to be, a male or a female, I don't think that's a bad thing. Like, you know, we should be encouraging people to firstly grab hold of their identity in Christ, and then also grab hold of their identity to fulfill their God-given commands, right? Like, men are commanded to do certain things, women are commanded to do certain. So how do we spread that, you know?
How do we spread that?
Yeah.
That's a good question.
Because we could have dull Christianity where men and women are basically liberals, like, right? Like, we could... Certain churches think they're spreading Jesus in a way that still repeats the same old stuff about men. It doesn't call you to step into your masculinity or your femininity.
Well, it's watered down Christianity where it's just like, Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you.
Jesus accepts you.
He accepts you. He tolerates your lifestyle. About,
yeah, tolerance and acceptance.
He doesn't care what you do. He loves you no matter what.
Right.
That's like what a lot of people do.
Yeah. So let me ask you this. Do you think it's good that we tell men to open up about their feelings more? Do you think that's actually the solution?
I think that's a good thing to tell men. I don't think it's a good thing to tell men to not share their emotions. I mean, obviously, like, there's a balance that needs to be had between, you know, being emotional and being stoic. I think that's a balance that you need to find as a man.
Yeah.
Because, like, being overly stoic will isolate you from people. And then being overly emotional will, like, make you really vulnerable. Yeah.
Well,
and, like,
you know, and telling men to just share their... Well, who are they going to share their feelings with?
That's a good point.
Modern men have no one to turn to a lot of the time. Because it's hard as a man to make friendships. And I'm not saying it's necessarily a whole lot better for women, because a lot of women are making bad friends, you know?
Well, yeah.
But...
I think it's actually easy to make friends, like, both ways. Because, I mean... It's not that hard. You just need to find somebody who shares interests with you.
Right.
But, like, finding a good friend who won't, like, stab you in the back, who you can actually, like, put your trust in, who you can actually open up to about your feelings and trust them not to, like, use what you told them against you.
Yeah.
I think that's, like, where, like, the hardship is. Because, like, you see a lot of, like, men talk online about, like, friends they used to have that they trusted, but then they... like, apparently, like, did something to stab them in the back.
Some terrible thing.
And, like,
yeah.
That's why a lot of men, like, don't even try to make friends anymore.
Right.
And, like, that's where I think it is. I don't think it's hard for men to make friends. I think it's just that, like, a lot of people just don't even want to try to make friends.
Because,
like, a lot of them are just afraid of opening up to somebody and then getting hurt.
Yeah, I think that there does have to be some level of men being able to take responsibility for themselves there. Like, I do not like it when... the trolls online tell men to just suck it up and deal with all their emotions and pain. But they have a point in that you have to be willing to take responsibility for yourself, right? We've created a culture where men don't have to take responsibility for themselves because the women now want to do it. And I think that everyone should take responsibility for themselves. But the problem is that now men are like, well, okay, feminism is great. Let's let women take responsibility for themselves and us too. You know, and then they learn quickly that feminism actually sucks.
Yeah.
And feminism actually leads to a lot of unhappiness and discontentment. And, I mean, I'm just going to say it. It leads to sexism.
That's true.
I think feminism is not necessarily fundamentally sexist, but what it's become is very sexist.
Oh, yeah.
So.
For sure.
You know, an ideal version of feminism would be one where women are called to... fulfill their truest identities as women, but
their God-given identities.
Yeah, but well, now
I think
feminism,
at that point it shouldn't be called feminism. Like even
well,
like,
I think it should be because we should change. The left loves to change the definition of words, right?
Yeah, that's true.
I think that we can play that game too. You know, I think we should change the definition of the rainbow so that when everybody thinks of rainbow, they don't think of gay people; they think of God's promise to Noah.
That's what it was originally, but they tried to change it.
When someone says happy holidays, we shouldn't get upset that they didn't say Merry Christmas. We should just say, okay, thank you for wishing me a Merry Christmas. I don't think it's wrong to leverage words in your favor. So I think that we should define feminism as calling women to step into their God-given identities as women.
Okay.
But the problem is that when feminism becomes anything other than that, we're calling them to step into an identity that destroys them and men as well.
All right, back to what you're saying. I think even then, like, it's still pretty, isolating to men, because I think we should like encourage men and women to work together to fulfill their God-given like duties. Like obviously, oh, yeah. like we as men and women, we have different God-given duties to fulfill, but like we shouldn't like focus on one and like ignore the other.
Right.
That's why I don't think we should.
I don't think feminism
I think we should
is
get rid of feminism altogether. I think we should just focus on having both people, like focus on giving them both a way to fulfill their God-given duties.
Sure. Yeah. And I'm not saying that feminism, defining feminism as allowing women to step into their true femininity. That doesn't mean that we exclude men.
Okay.
It just means that we encourage women to be women.
All right.
Because that's what feminism should be, right?
Fair enough. Okay.
Feminism at its core was meant to help women. Modern feminism is not helping women. It's destroying women and men.
Yep.
And, I mean, you know, the Bible talks a lot about, like, you know, the influence of a woman. Like, in Proverbs, it says that it's better to eat a meal of herbs than to live with a contentious woman. Essentially, I think that's what the verse says.
Yeah, it's something like that.
We, as men, we can say,
"Oh no, you're gonna get called out for misquoting scripture again."
They can shut up. whatever. I know it says something like that in the Bible. I apologize if I don't have it word for word in the New King James Version of the Bible. But you know, we can. The Bible says that men are supposed to take leadership positions, but it never denies the influence of women.
Okay, I understand.
In the family, or really in culture, I don't think, right? No. You know, women are human beings, believe it or not.
What?
Yeah, I know, shocking.
What do you mean by that?
Women have a lot of influence, and we should encourage them to use that influence for good, to help themselves and to help men, because when men and women both step into their true identities in Christ and in their masculinity and femininity, that's when culture finds itself in a much better spot.
Because
right now we just have war, you know, constant war. And right now women are up on top. But if Andrew Tate got his way, men would constantly be on top. You ever notice that? Both sides want to come out on top. Neither side wants what's Ooh. Best for the other. Both sides just want to come out on top.
Interesting. And that's an interesting thing to say.
I personally think that Andrew Tate says more good things than left-wing feminists do. But that doesn't mean that I want a world where everyone follows Andrew Tate's
teachings. I do think Andrew Tate has a very good influence on culture. Like, he's making a positive impact. I think you are right. I think if Andrew Tate, like, got his way, then it would go extreme in the other direction.
Well, you know, I know you listen to Andrew Klavan, right?
Andrew Klavan?
Yeah.
Once in a while. I like
Once
him
in
more.
A while, yeah.
I like him more than the other Daily Wire hosts. I just think He's
funny.
He's funny, and he's also like less focused on like strictly politics stuff and more on just cultural stuff in general.
Well,
which I think is interesting.
What he was saying, I listened to him this past week, I think, about a week ago now. And he was saying that there's little that horrifies him more than, I think he said something to the effect of Andrew Tate's gaggle of supporters who have found out that women can be manipulated.
Oh.
And I was like, okay, wait, I got to think about this. And I thought about it, and the truth is, I came back with mostly the same conclusion I've always had about Andrew Tate, which is that he's a bad person promoting a few good ideas.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, I can totally see where Klavan is coming from, that, you know, a lot of Andrew Tate's teaching is about manipulating women, right? Like, he thinks that it's fine for you to have multiple wives, so to speak, call them wives, you know, and he thinks it's fine for men to do whatever they dang well please, and that women simply exist to serve men, right? And he
well, that's you know, Andrew Tate's Islamic, and that's what Islam religion
but
teaches.
But he essentially said one day that I'm blanking now. But I think he basically admitted to dating women, sleeping with them, and then after he slept with them, then he would convince them to join his webcam business.
Ooh.
Which speaks
that
he bragged about it. He used to brag about it, I think. You won't
see
any
awful.
Of those clips floating around on the internet because they don't want you to see those.
That's true.
But that's where I'm getting my point that both sides want to manipulate the other, right? Women want men to think that they're the problem, and if they just solve their ways, if they just suck it up, everything will be fine, and that we should live in a matriarchy where women make more money than men and don't have to have kids. We can just grow them in a lab somewhere. And then Andrew Tate wants us all to manipulate women and teach them how to be our servants. And neither side has the right answer for society. So.
No, they don't.
So it comes back to what you were saying, that Jesus is the solution. Jesus is the
right answer.
For society.
He is, because, like, he's not extreme on one side or the other, because he's in the perfect
Christ is very extreme. Middle. Christ is very extreme.
Well, he's extreme, but, like, he's
Christ
not.
Christ is radical. His teachings are extremely radical, but his teachings are correct, because he made the whole world.
They're the correct extreme, is what I'm saying. Like, they're not extreme. Like, he's not extremely on the side of women or extremely on the side of men. Like, he's not, like.
Well, he's on the side of women and men.
The Bible never says
one
sex is better than the other. Right. Like, it teaches, like, that we're, you know, we all matter equally to God.
Yeah.
Like, we're all, like, of equal moral value to God, but we have different roles, and it teaches about the different roles men and women have.
Mm-hmm.
And it teaches that men should be leaders, and women should, you know, they should assist the man with their leadership and, like,
right.
you know, head the house, like, take care of the household and stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's culture's solution, right?
Yes.
That's what we should tell people.
We should tell people about Jesus is what the moral of this discussion is.
Yes.
Preach the gospel. Bring people to Jesus.
Amen. All right. Amen. That'll do it for the first segment of the W Ritz podcast. We're clocking in at 26:26 right now.
Ooh.
Perfect time.
Perfect timing.
All right.
You wasted
we'll be back.
Seconds.
So we'll be back.
26:30.
Oh, 35 actually. We'll be back after this sweet transition music.
39.
Shut up.
Good morning, my lovely listeners, and welcome to the second segment of the W Ritz Podcast, episode, whatever episode
15,
we're on now. 15,
probably? 14?
15, 16, 17, 18, I don't know. One of the episodes.
18-yard touchdown!
You viewer, or you listener, rather. We don't have a video camera set up yet, but you certainly are listening to a W Ritz Podcast episode. I don't know. At the time you're listening to it, it might be the newest one, or it might be a really old one. And
yeah.
We might have, like, 400
We might be 60 by the time you listen to this. You never know.
Yeah. You know, we might be dead. It could be.
You're really behind.
You could be listening to this, like, 400 years in the future, and, like, this is, like, the only record of,
you could be listening
that you have of, like, the 2020 era.
You could be listening to this in history class to see what it was like back now.
That's true. We could be part of a history curriculum.
True.
That would be really weird if, like, we were part of the history curriculum.
That would mean the history was really bad.
That was, yeah. Because, like, if we're the only record they have of, like, the history of the early 2000s.
Right.
Well, it's not really early 2000s anymore. But I guess relative, if it's, like.
Relative to the rest of time, yeah.
If it's 21, like, 20 by the time you're listening to this, then, yeah, it's pretty early 2000s. Anyway, enough beating around the bush. We're doing another tier list this week, guys. But, you know, in concurrence with the start of the football season, I thought it would be fun to do a football-themed tier list. And it's not going to be, like, judging, like, the actual teams or anything, like, because, like...
Because some of them are...
Everybody does that. Like,
some of them
I'm sure
suck.
That's true.
Looking at you, Detroit Lions.
Wow.
Anyway,
I'm supposed to be
unbiased.
Detroit Lions, they beat the Chiefs the first week. So how can you call them bad?
Because
anymore?
Historically they've been bad.
Well, they're not bad anymore. They beat the Chiefs, and for that, in my heart, they're the second best team. Second All right. To
well,
the Bills,
we respect them for beating our longtime rivals.
Anyway, but everybody judges the teams based on of how good they are, how many Super Bowls they've won. You know how handsome the players are. Everybody
does
that.
Their quarterback is hot.
Yeah, or their kicker is hot. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But we're just gonna judge the teams purely based off of their logo design. Because that seems very simple and fun to do. So
right.
Here we have all, 32 teams?
It looks like about 32, yeah.
Yep. So we're going to, just so you all know, we're going to be incredibly biased during this. So
I thought we were going to be unbiased.
No, biased. We're going to be so freaking biased. So if you get offended by biased opinions.
You're a snowflake.
Then screw you. Then screw you. Every opinion is biased.
So
there's no such thing as an unbiased opinion, you idiot.
Okay, true. All right. What do we got?
I think because I think we should just start off with the objective best logo, the Buffalo Bills.
Oh, yeah.
I told you were going to be biased, but like even if you like hate the Bills.
Oh, we forgot to go through our categories, Will.
Oh, our category. Okay. Well, because, you know, it's a football tier list, we thought we'd make the categories football themed. So at the top, you know, the best tier is touchdown, of course.
Oh, yeah.
Touchdown. And then the second, you know, the second to the top tier, you know, the A tier is first down because, you know, you're always happy when you get a first down. And then, you know, the mid tier, you know, the B tier is yardage, which means, you know, you got like 2 yards, but you didn't get a first down.
Mm-hmm.
It's something, I mean, but it's not anything spectacular. And then you get down to the C tier, which is fumble, which is...
That's when you really start to screw up.
Yeah. That's gut-wrenching. That's like, oh,
no one wants to see you fumble the ball. No.
And then the final tier, the worst tier, the F tier, is called kickoff return TD. Because
we're looking at you, Buffalo Bills.
If you're watching a football game and like the game is really close and it's an overtime, and then you get the ball first, your team gets the ball first, and then they fail to even get a first down, and then you're feeling really bad, and then they kick off the ball, the other team gets the ball, and they run, and they keep running, and they don't get tackled, and they keep running, and they keep running, and then next thing you know, you lost the game. That is the worst feeling a football fan can feel ever.
Well, especially after the team that lost to a team that just lost their all-star quarterback earlier in the game.
That was okay. Like, obviously, I hope Aaron Rodgers, like, isn't, you know, permanently injured. I hope he, like, gets, you know, a speedy recovery. But I do think it is rather funny that the first time he was sacked in the entire season, he was injured.
I know, right? Just a little bit.
A little bit amusing.
Of course it happened when he plays with the Jets.
But I do like Aaron Rodgers as a person. He's a really cool person.
Yeah.
Anyway, let's get to the actual tier list. Buffalo Bills.
Touchdown tier, baby.
Best logo. Okay.
I mean, it has the red, white, and blue.
I did say we were going to be biased, but like even if you hate the Bills, you got to admit our logo is really iconic and cool.
Which is a good thing because everyone wears the logo, man.
That's true.
Like, I am pretty sure that if it were the Bills versus, the Chiefs in the Super Bowl, everybody would be rooting for the Bills because we built up some national credibility
exactly.
and sympathy.
But, like, just look at the design. It's, like, it's a buffalo running through a ribbon, and it's got, like, a streaked ribbon, like, attached to its horn. It's so cool. It's so iconic.
Yes.
Like, it's probably the most recognizable football logo of them all. Like, besides, like, the actual NFL system.
Besides,
probably even more.
Yeah, maybe the Patriots, because they won so many.
That's true. Maybe the Patriots, but, like... And also, red, white, and blue, America, love that. Color scheme. Best color scheme of them all. So, Buffalo Bills go at the top. All right, now we'll just go in order the way the tiers.
All right, we got the Arizona Cardinals.
The Cardinals, I would just say yardage, because...
Hmm.
What do you think, Isaac?
I think that it's actually pretty creative of a logo.
Really?
Like, it is an actual cardinal. Like,
but, like, I'm pretty sure I was part of, like, a baseball team growing up that had that same exact logo.
Okay, you might have been. I don't know. I feel like I'm more biased to, like, actual drawings better than just, like, letter logos.
Gotcha.
Right?
Okay.
So I think it is. I think yardage is fair.
I think yardage, yeah.
Definitely fair. A good logo, but not the best.
Okay, the Falcons? I think that's also a touchdown logo.
It is pretty cool.
It's
even intimidating.
It's a falcon, but like they shaped it in a way that it's an F. So like it's both like an animal and the letter at the same time.
And it's pretty intimidating.
And like the color scheme is really cool, like the black and red. And it's just a really cool, well-designed logo. Like
I would say same goes for the Baltimore Ravens logo too.
You think touchdown tier?
Touchdown or first down?
I think first down. Because like it's a good logo. Like maybe not quite as cool as the Falcons one, but I do like the B. I like the purple, black, and gold color scheme. That's a really cool color scheme. Yeah, I think that's just a good logo.
I don't know. I don't know what it is with all the first three being bird logos. You know.
That's true. Lots of bird teams.
I know, right?
Well, next one is not a bird team.
But it might eat a bird.
Yes, it's the Panthers. What do you think, Isaac?
I'd say yardage.
Same.
It's okay, but the colors are too similar. Like
also similar to like the Cardinals, where it's just like, it's good, but it's kind of basic.
Yeah,
like, they're not like creative with it. It's just a panther. Like
it's just a bunch of dark blue.
It's dark blue, and it's just a panther. Okay.
All right.
Like they didn't do anything creative, like with the Falcons or the the Baltimore Ravens or the Bills.
Yeah.
Like, they all took the animal and did something creative with it. Like, that's what I like in a logo. They
right.
just take an animal and they do something creative to make it an iconic logo.
Right.
Or it's just a panther. It's just a panther.
It's cool,
with his mouth
but
open.
It's not great.
It's cool, but could be better.
Yep.
Next one, I think we have our first outright bad logo, in my opinion. And it's the Chicago Bears. It's just the C.
It's just a big red C.
It's
you
just
the
C.
You couldn't even draw a bear.
Like
a bear would have been cool.
I'm pretty sure like they used to, or at some point, had like an actual bear.
It probably triggered some people who don't like bears.
Like, imagine not liking bears. Bears are cool.
I know, right?
You
anyway.
Think it's the worst, like in the worst tier?
I would say kickoff return touchdown, yeah. Because, you know, the Chicago Bears, I mean, they're from Chicago, right? So, of course, they're going to suck. But it's also like they should call themselves the Chicago Teddy Bears, man. Like, come on. There aren't even bears in Chicago, you know?
That's true. Like, what?
At least in Buffalo, we have bison
called, like,
roaming around the public streets.
That's true. Yeah, exactly.
You ever, like, you know, you could go to downtown Buffalo. We have a big prairie in front of City Hall
exactly.
where thousands of buffalo are known to roam.
So many.
So, yeah, the Chicago one is bad.
It's just bad.
All right.
And next up, we have the Bengals, which I'd put in fumble.
I'd say it's okay. Like, I like that it has the stripes.
The stripes are cool. The
orange is a good color.
Orange and black is a cool color scheme. But, again,
it's just the big B. So, all right.
And then the Cleveland Browns.
My gosh. They literally just took a flippin' football helmet.
It's just an orange football helmet.
Colored it orange and hoped
it would... Kickoff return touchdown.
Yeah.
Put that... It's like if you were, like, in a video game. Like, creating, like, your own football team. And, like, that's just, like, the default. That's
right.
What it looks like. That looks like the default football logo.
Yeah.
That's what it looks like.
It's almost like one of those when they're in movies and they're trying to not copyright things. Like, instead of saying NFL, they'll say the whatever it is, football league. Like, that looks like it would be the logo for some off-brand,
it looks like the default team.
In some cheesy school movie.
Yeah, it looks like just the most uncreative, did not try at all.
Yeah.
Thing.
All right.
Dallas Cowboys.
I would...
Because I'm biased.
You know...
Because I'm biased, I'm going to say first down. What about you?
I would have to disagree. It's just a blue star.
I am biased, though, because I do like the Cowboys because one of my close friends is a huge Cowboys fan.
All right. Well, let's put it in yardage because it's the same as, like, the Panthers. Like,
I do think it's cool, though.
It's
like,
just a bunch of blue.
It's simple, but it's effective, you know. It's just a blue star, but, like,
fair enough,
you know,
but
it's
I don't think they put enough creativity in it for it to be anything better than yardage.
Fair enough.
You know?
Fair enough.
All right.
The Denver Broncos.
I mean, it's a horse with an orange mane.
I mean, I think also yardage.
Yeah. I would say it could have been more creative, for sure.
Could have been.
It's cool, but not that cool.
It's cool. Like, it's a horse.
Yeah.
Like, again, like with the Cardinals and the Panthers, it's just the animal. It's just the head of the animal. They didn't do anything else with it.
Right. Okay. Detroit Lions.
The Detroit Lions. It's a blue lion.
It's a blue lion. I think fumble.
Fumble?
Because at least it's not like a letter.
That's true.
With no other colors, right?
I mean, at least with, like, the other animals we put in yardage, like, you can at least see the face of the animal. It's just a blue line.
Right. It's not that cool. It looks like it would be a refrigerator magnet.
It does.
For some school football team. So
it does look like that.
All right. I have to make a joke here. Next up, we have the Green Bay Packers.
Ha!
Yeah.
Do you guys get it?
I'm only saying that
Do you guys get it because, like, he likes the band Green Day and,
yeah,
like, it rhymes with Green Bay?
No, I literally.
So he said Green Day instead of Green Bay.
I literally do make that joke. I actually sometimes call them the Green Day Packers on mistake because, like, I think about Green Day a lot more than I think about the Packers.
That
so.
Makes a lot of sense. Green Bay Packers.
Okay. It is a letter. It is a letter logo.
It is
logo.
A letter, but I do like the color scheme.
Yeah.
And
since it rhymes with Green Day, I feel like yardage is appropriate.
No, fumble.
Fumble?
It's not that good.
Yeah. Okay, fair enough.
It's not that good.
It's not great. Although it is recognizable.
It is very recognizable. A lot more so than
just because the
Bears
Packers are, you know.
The Browns.
Browns.
Okay.
Imagine naming your team the Browns.
The Browns is probably the most forgettable football team because, like,
the Cleveland
whenever
Browns.
Like the Bills or like I see anything about the Browns, it always I always do a double take and I'm like, oh yeah. They exist.
Yeah.
So like, if like you were to quiz me
and
to
now
like
playing
if,
the
like,
Anchorage white people,
if like one, some like you know YouTuber like came up to me on the street and was like, name every football team in the NFL, I would probably be able to name all of them. But like if I were to forget one, it would be the Browns.
Right. All right.
Anyway, moving on.
We got the Dallas Texans, right?
No, not Dallas.
The Houston.
Houston
Texans.
This
is a cool logo.
It is a cool
I'm
logo.
Not gonna
I'm
lie.
I'm gonna say first down.
Like it is actually creative.
Cause like it's. Got the horns
and it's red, white, and blue again. You know,
head, but like
it has a star in it.
Red, white, and blue, and it's got a star for an eye. That's cool.
Yeah, that you know. Yeah. All right. Okay, we got the Indianapolis Colts.
Indianapolis Colts.
Fittingly, their logo is a horseshoe.
A horseshoe.
I mean, they could have done better.
It's, you know,
it's all right.
A horseshoe. You know, that's. I mean, it's iconic.
It's cool.
It could be better.
They didn't. They basically took a blue horseshoe and added some white little dots in it.
They did.
I would say fumble.
Fumble? Yeah. I would agree.
Like, almost. It's almost good enough to be yardage because it's, like, kind of recognizable and iconic, but it's not great.
What I find really funny is at one point the Colts used to have a quarterback named Andrew Luck. And if you don't know,
yeah.
an upward-facing horseshoe is a sign of good luck.
Right.
So I think that's funny.
You would find that funny.
I would find that funny. Just like you would find Green Bay Packers funny.
Ah. I don't actually find that very funny. I just like to say it anyway.
Because you think it's funny.
Because I like Green Bay.
Oh, okay. All right, next up, the Jacksonville Jaguars.
It's another animal logo, guys.
So yardage. It's just the head of a jaguar.
It's, I mean, it's kind of cool, but like, you know, it's uncreative.
They have a cool.
They went to Google and they're like, jaguar photo, and then they did some stuff to it in Adobe Photoshop, and now it's their logo.
Yeah, I mean, the color scheme is cool, like the sort of dark orange and the dark green and the white. That looks really nice.
But again, it looks like it belongs on a high school football team.
All right, Kansas City Chiefs. As much as I loathe the Chiefs for taking away our chance at the Super Bowl, not once, but twice.
Mm-hmm.
Their logo is pretty cool, I will admit.
I'd say it's decent, yeah.
Because like
first down,
I mean, it
first
is the,
down
it
level.
It is the letters, but like they have like the arrowhead.
Yeah.
It makes it really recognizable. I'd put it in first down.
All right. What is this team, Will?
That's the Los Angeles Chargers.
Okay.
It's just the lightning bolt.
Some of these I'm not. Some of them are so abstract. I don't know. All right. What do you say?
I honestly don't know. I can't decide if it's cool or boring.
I would say it's boring.
I'd say yeah. Just put in fumble. I'd say the Chargers.
You could really do better.
It's just a lightning bolt.
Yeah.
Like they could have like, I don't know what they could have done. Like maybe they could have done like a lightning letters where it's like Los Angeles, so it's the Wait, no, they're not Los Angeles, are they? Because wait, I see the Rams are Los Angeles.
Yeah, I think Los Angeles has two football teams, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah, I think they do. Do they? Oh yeah, just like New York City has two.
Yeah,
like they have the Jets and the Giants.
Yeah. All right. Speaking of the Los Angeles Rams, we have their logo now.
I think their logo is actually pretty cool.
It's okay. It has the letter thing.
But it
curves into a ram horn.
The ram horn. I mean, the old logo used to just be the animal, right?
Right.
I think
so.
I remember that. I think the new one is pretty cool.
So what'd you say? Like, first down?
I'd put it in first down. I think it's cool. Also, I'd also like to say, I like the design of their uniforms. The Rams uniforms were like, instead of just having the logo on the side of their helmet, they have actual ram horns.
Yeah, that's cool.
I like it when football teams just like, They get creative with, like, the actual uniform designs.
Right. Right. Okay. Next, we have what I actually think is a very cool logo. I'm not going to lie.
The L.A. Raiders.
The Las Vegas.
The Las Vegas
Raiders. I like it.
Return at kickoff touchdown because they're facing the Bills today. But
well,
we're winning, actually, so we can be unbiased.
Okay.
We're winning at the time that we're recording this
right
now. I don't know if by the end of this, the Bills are going to get another kickoff return touchdown during overtime and lose the game.
I think that this belongs in first down category.
You think maybe touchdown?
Maybe.
It's cool. It's like a pirate.
Well, let's put
it's got a shield design.
Let's put it at the top of first down for now. Maybe we'll change it.
Maybe we'll go through and do some edits later.
All right, we got the Miami Dolphins. This is...
It's another animal, but, like, they have a sun behind it, and it's so iconic.
They
and,
have
like,
a sun behind it.
The color scheme is really cool. I'd put it in first down.
But
first
it's not time. Menacing. It doesn't show anything cool.
That's true.
I'd say yardage, man, just like all the other animal logos. All
right, you can put it in yardage.
Thanks, bro. All right, next up, we have the Minneapolis Vikings.
Minnesota Vikings.
Whoops. Same state.
Okay. Is it? Wait.
Minneapolis, Minnesota. Learn your geography, bro.
You right.
I know right. One of you is going to be in the comments and be like, Isaac, you're wrong about that. You
and
know
it will
I'm
be,
not.
And it will be Noah Freeberg because he likes the Minnesota Vikings.
Why?
And he's from Minnesota. I think he's from Minnesota.
Okay, all right, fair enough.
I might be wrong.
This is a neat logo, but I don't love it. The color scheme is
it's cool. It's
the color
Vikings.
Scheme is too much yellow.
I like the color scheme of the Vikings. It's purple and gold. That's my favorite color scheme. But also, I'm pretty sure a school on Grand Island uses the same exact logo for the Vikings.
I think so.
Fairly certain. Like, it's the same exact logo. Now, I don't know if that's, like, illegal or something, or, like,
they
how
probably,
that happened.
They probably bought the mark, the trademark thing.
The trademark?
Yeah. I would say, I don't know. You decide. I don't care.
You don't care? Where would you put it?
I would put it in, like, fumble.
Fumble? I wouldn't say it's that bad. We'll put it in yardage.
Okay.
All right. Patriots.
We got New England Patriots, baby.
Kickoff return touchdown. Screw those fucking guys.
Yeah, they suck.
Okay, but honestly, their logo is pretty cool.
Yeah, their logo is
cool. I mean, it's got the red, white, and blue. Actually, it's, like, more red, navy, blue, and silver.
Yeah, and then they got the cool little guy
there. I would put it in first down, honestly, because it's very iconic.
I would agree. All right, we got the Saints.
Like the Saints logo.
It's cool.
I mean,
it's good.
We have that symbol in our house. I don't know what you call that symbol.
I don't know.
Definitely didn't originate with the Saints. It's like it means something. I don't know what it means, though.
Yeah. I would say
it's
first
like
down.
A crest of some, yeah, I would say first down, too.
Okay.
Also, I like the gold and black color scheme.
Yeah. All right, we got the New York Giants.
Kickoff return touchdown. They have the most boring logo in the entire...
It does.
Second to the Browns. Because it's just NY.
Yeah.
There's no...
Like,
the
font is cool, but come on.
At least the Chicago Bears, like, they have, like, an actual orange thing, and they got a little... They shaped it a little bit.
Yeah.
The New York Giants, it's just an NY with like a little bit longer
of
a Y stem. It's so boring.
Okay, New York Jets.
I think also kickoff return touchdown.
I think they deserve it a little bit higher than that
because
their logo is recognizable.
It's recognizable, but like they
could
have made
it. It is in the shape of the football too.
Why is it a football though? Why isn't it a jet?
I don't know.
Why isn't it like a jet and like along like the side of the jet they have like just the Jets on it or like New York?
You ask good questions.
That would be cooler. They really fumbled the design there.
Philadelphia Eagles.
I mean, it's just another animal head.
Yeah.
I think to keep it consistent, we put it all in yardage.
I would agree. Yardage
because
is our biggest category so
any,
far.
Any just animal head, it's just an animal head and nothing else added, I think goes in yardage.
Right.
Like any animal heads that they do incorporate
they
something
do
creative.
They do nothing to,
in,
yeah.
If they incorporate it something creative into the animal
like
head.
Like the Houston Texans and Baltimore Ravens.
Or the Falcons with like the cool F.
Where they actually add, yeah, that can go in touchdown or first down, but otherwise it's just yardage.
Yeah, I think, yeah. So
all right, Steelers.
Steelers?
I mean, it's kind of boring, not going to lie.
It's recognizable, though.
It's recognizable like, and boring.
It's recognizably boring, so I'd say put in fumble then.
I'd say top of fumble.
Because like, it's just like, three stars. Like
right.
Isn't that the team that used to be the Oilers? I know one of the teams in the NFL used to be called the Oilers.
I do not know.
I think it was the Steelers.
Might have been.
I might be wrong, but I'm pretty sure it was the Steelers.
Huh. All right. Now we have my least favorite team in the NFL.
Really?
For whatever reason. The Seattle Seahawks.
Why do you hate the Seattle Seahawks?
I don't know.
Of all the teams to hate, why the Seattle Seahawks?
There's something about them I don't like.
See, I always sort of like them.
I mean, the Baltimore Ravens and the Kansas City Chiefs definitely are up there for me. Maybe I don't hate the Seattle Seahawks the most, but there's something about them I don't like.
I mean, it definitely can't be because of their relationship to the Bills because, like, they're in a completely different conference. So, like,
right.
they do nothing to us. I always kind of liked them, but that's only because as a kid, whenever me and my brothers played Madden, like, they would pick the Bills, obviously, so I would always pick something else, and I always picked the Seahawks for some reason. I don't know why, I just did.
Oh,
I guess I thought they were cool.
Well, it's another animal logo.
But, like, I guess put in yardage.
There's nothing,
it looks a little bit more interesting than the other ones, but again, it's not too special.
All right, San Francisco 49ers.
I think fumble, because it's just the letters, but like they add something to it.
It looks
it's not like the New York Giants where it's just the letters.
It looks like it should be a rural chain of gas stations logo.
It does. It does look like a football logo. It looks like, it looks like a gas station logo. It looks like a pizza logo like you'd get at a gas station.
It looks like a nice little gas station I'd love to go to, but not a football team.
The Tampa Bay Buccaneers.
Sorry, this is a touchdown category logo.
I love that logo.
They add the sword and the pirate flag.
It's the sword with the pirate. Pirates are so cool. It's just a cool logo.
Even though Tom Brady played on that team, still.
I don't care. It's a cool logo, and Tom Brady's retired anyway.
Yeah, he did actually retire now. He didn't come back this year.
I think he... Maybe he'll come back like halfway.
He'll probably come back next year.
Yeah.
Be like, man, that was a nice vacation.
That was a nice vacation. What do you mean I retired? I just took a vacation.
What do you mean I retired? I just took a little time to divorce my wife. I'm back now. All right. Tennessee Titans.
The Tennessee Titans.
This is a good logo. I would say it's a first down level logo for sure.
I would agree with that.
Like top of first down category.
Yeah.
That's it has, you know, like, the fireball type thing.
The fireball and the color scheme, like the blue, like the focus on blue, but then like the little red highlights makes it really unique.
And then like the almost Tesla style logo for the T.
The Tennessee Teslas.
The Tennessee Teslas. They run on
that
electricity.
That team gets sponsored by Elon Musk.
Right.
That would be really funny.
But Will, now we have the objective worst.
The worst
logo in the entire NFL for a lot of reasons.
The Washington Commanders.
No, it's the Washington football team.
No, they're the Commanders now.
Oh, they changed it to Commanders?
They changed it last year.
Oh, it's about time. Okay.
I'm behind.
I don't follow them, But like still, it's like
still
they changed it from the Redskins, which was so cool.
That was such a cool logo. Like, honestly,
all the Indians were saying it didn't even offend them.
Why would it even offend you? Like, why? Because like you get your entire like ethnicity represented by a team.
That's pretty cool.
That's
like,
really cool.
I would like it if there were
if they look
Nebraska white people. Like that would be cool.
I wouldn't Nebraska like that. Caucasians.
Yeah. And it's a team filled
Lucas
with, it's a
Lucas
team with a bunch
sent
of,
me a
it's
meme
a team
once
with
that
a bunch
that,
of black
or like
people
put
on
a meme
it.
In the server.
It's a team with a bunch of black people on it. The Nebraska Caucasians.
That would be funny. Or like if they put like a Nintendo sponsored a team and they like called it like what's a city that doesn't have a football team?
Let's say Charlottesville.
Charlottesville Mario Brothers. I wouldn't be offended as an Italian. I would not.
All
be
of them
offended.
Are required.
I
to
love
wear,
Mario.
Are, all of them are required to at least wear fake mustaches during games.
That would be so funny.
But the Washington Commanders definitely worst football logo team
it's,
logo in the NFL.
Okay, it's not just because we're not putting it down there just because of the logo, just because the previous logo used to be so good and this is such a downgrade.
Like they
because
they
like
decided.
objectively it's more interesting than the Giants or the Bears.
Yeah.
But like
they decided to fall down the stairs.
Exactly. They decided to regress the logo design.
Right.
Like they at least I believe the New York Giants logo has stayed mostly consistent throughout the NFL history. But I'm pretty sure. But at least that, but Commanders, they fell off.
Yeah,
Washington fell off.
All right.
Anyway, that's
there
the
we
end
have
of the
it.
Tier list.
That's the end of the second segment as well.
Yeah, that was a good discussion.
Oh, yeah. We're at the 53-minute mark, so we got like 7 minutes left for the podcast. But we will be adding at the end of this podcast, we're going to do a cover of a certain song. We'll announce it soon in the third segment.
Because we haven't decided yet.
Yeah, or at least we want you to believe that.
Have we or have we haven't decided?
I don't know. We have to debate. We have to
let
debate.
Us know in the comments below.
Yeah. Predict right now and then listen to the rest of the podcast and delete your comment if it was wrong.
And then repost the correct answer. That way you look smart.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
For all the other like 5 people who look at the comments. All right. Thanks for listening to the second segment.
We will be posting this completed tier list in the
community
tab. And let us know what you would change, what you where you think the team should be.
Even though you will be wrong if you disagree with us.
We were objective. Even though we said we would be biased, we are objectively right. These are.
I mean, we were actually discussing the artistic qualities of these.
We
logos,
were.
So.
We were. Yeah, we should be NFL logo designers.
I mean, why not?
Why not?
Why not?
Why not?
Welcome to the third segment of the W Ritz Podcast. I'm your host,
Isaac.
Oh yeah, that is my name. I forgot.
Yeah, you didn't say anything afterwards, so I thought I'd help you out there.
Oh,
you're welcome.
All right, well, William, we are going to be doing a cover of a certain song for the third segment.
Ooh,
we've started doing covers for the third segment of our podcast because they're fun to do.
They're fun to do.
I like to play drums, and Will likes to sing, which is why he joined the choir.
If you didn't know, I did join my church's choir. That's where I go after this podcast.
Yes, that's right.
Oh, maybe we'll be able to catch the last quarter of the Bills game.
I don't know. I guess we'll see.
We'll see.
In any case, we are going to be covering the Alabama theme song, also known as the incest theme song.
Hey, yo, bro. Okay. Give the Alabamans a break. They didn't do nothing wrong.
Well, some of them did.
I guess.
Anyway. Why did they get to criticize us for being Yankees and we can't call them Confederates?
Confederates?
Stupid Confederates.
I don't know, bro.
Anti-Southern racism percent.
Who's more oppressed, the North or the South?
I mean, it depends on what state you choose to be gay in.
Fair enough. Good answer.
Anyway, the Alabama theme song, also known as Sweet Home Alabama by Lynyrd Skynyrd, is coming up. I actually want to say that Sweet Home Alabama is a really good song. Like, unironically, it is a good song.
And for those of you who don't know, it's actually a diss track because, if you didn't know, the writer of the song, Lynyrd Skynyrd, wrote it in response to another song called Southern Man. I forgot who it was by, but that song was like made to make fun of Southern people, and Sweet Home Alabama was made as a response to basically say, hey, you're wrong. The South is actually a cool place to live in.
Yep.
Stupid.
Unless you're black.
Hey, yo.
All right. So this is for this performance of the song Sweet Home Alabama by Lynyrd Skynyrd, Will and I are rebranding ourselves as a different group. So here is our cover of Sweet Home Alabama by Winner Dinner.
Made by Yankees.
Yes.
1, 2, 3. Big old wheels keep on turning, carrying me home to see my kin, singing songs about the Southland. I miss a Bammy once again. Well, I heard Miss Young sing about her. I heard her nail put her down. Well, I hope Brown Young will remember. A Southern man don't need him around anyhow. Sweet Home Alabama, where the skies are so blue. Sweet Home Alabama, Lord, I'm coming home to you. In Birmingham, they love the governor. Boo! Now we all did what we could do. Now Watergate does not bother me. Does your conscience bother you? Tell the truth. Sweet Home Alabama, where the skies are so blue.
sweet home Alabama. Lord, I'm coming home to you, Alabama. Feeling blue. Now how about you? Sweet home Alabama, where the skies are so blue. Sweet home Alabama, Lord, I'm coming home to you. Sweet home Alabama.
Sweet home, baby.
Where the skies are the blue and governor's true. Sweet home Alabama, Lord, I'm coming home to you.
Real smooth.